to a folder in my drive, and that drive link already I will be sharing that in the Google Classroom. So I will not be sharing every day the link to you in the class group, because there will be too many links coming to you. So what I will do is the shared this recorded video I will be sharing in one folder in the Google Drive, and that folder I will be sharing it with you in the Google Classroom. So as and when the class overs, within that evening or by that night, you will be getting that video to you. Okay, so you will get every recorded lecture video to you, so you need not to worry. Learning materials already I have given to you in the Google Classroom. I have uploaded one textbook PDF form and my handwritten notes of module 1. Okay, so as of now, for this the end of module 1, you don't have any scarcity about the learning materials. Okay, study material you have with you now. And as per the instructions decided by the Dean Academics and the higher ups, the class is broken into 3 sections. There will not be single hour monotonous class. The lecture will be for 30 to 40 minutes. Depends whether it is 1 hour class or 55 minutes class. The lecture will be for around 30 to 35 or 40 minutes. After that, a small review or recap will be done, or discussions from your side can be done. And it is expected that every student have to attend quiz at the end of the each class. Quiz subjective to the course defined by the course instructor. Okay. Today there will not be any quiz because it is a very introduction class. So whenever there will be quiz, I will be telling you at the start of the class only. So that quiz was intended to make you people attentive to the entire class session. Okay, now you cannot and these quiz marks, whatever you will be scoring, these quiz marks will be considered for final assignment evaluation. This is not our rule, it is by the Dean Academics to make you attentive to the classes. Okay, so we'll start with the session. Are you able to share the see the screen? Introduction to course?
No, sir.
No, sir.
I think I have to share the window only. Yeah. Now is it visible? Is it visible now? Introduction to course 18E32 electric circuit analysis.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Very good. So now the subject is electric circuit analysis. Okay, the subject is electric circuit analysis. So first we'll see what is electric circuit, and then we'll see what we have to analyze. Once we are we know what is the dictionary meaning of our subject name, some part of the battle is won, because we will be very clear what we are doing in our subject. Ultimately, what we are doing in our course, we will be very clear. So what is circuit? Before we go to electric circuit, we'll see what is circuit first. So what is circuit? Circuit, okay, in my view, it is a closed system. Okay. It is a closed system, okay, where some work is done. You can call it as a system also, okay, where you can say not some, where a particular work is done. Particular work is done. Now, what are the different circuits we have come across in our lives? When we say circuit, usually come in front of our eyes, we get only a resistor, a capacitor, only electrical components we come we'll get in front of our eyes, because more often when we called circuit, it came under electrical heading only. We did not think much beyond electrical system, where does the circuit exists. Okay, the circuits maybe you can classify here. Okay, the circuits may be, I will come to electrical at the last. Before electrical, I will say which are the other circuits. Okay, generally what we see in everyday life: thermal circuit, are the letters visible?
Yes, sir.
Hope you are comfortable looking on the writing.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. If you feel any discomfort in reading or things, you please tell me. Okay, I can write the bigger letters. So one is thermal circuit. You can say optical circuit. You can have a fluid circuit. Or you can call it as a hydraulic circuit. Okay, hydraulic circuit. You can have a pneumatic circuit. So we have all come across these things. So last I will take it as an electric circuit, okay? Because that is our point of interest. I will write it as electric circuit. Okay. Now we know that in thermal circuit, what is the energy that is flowing? Yes. In thermal circuit. You can speak. Anybody can speak.
Sir, is it heat?
Heat. Yes, exactly. Heat. Optical circuit.
Light.
Light and lasers.
Light or photon. Hydraulic circuit, it is fluid. Okay, because already I have written there. Okay, pneumatic circuit.
Air.
Yeah, it is air or gas. Okay, any type of gas. Now tell what is an electric circuit.
Electrons.
Yeah. Electrons or charge carriers. Now can you imagine a thermal circuit without flow of heat? No.
No, sir.
Is it? Without heat, I cannot call it as a thermal circuit. Without light or photons, I cannot call it as optical circuit. Without fluid, I cannot call it as fluid circuit. Likewise, pneumatic and electric. So there are some quantities, there are some energies. Here it is a light energy. Here it is heat energy. Here it is light energy. Here it is fluid energy. Here it is gas. Here it is electrons. There is some flow of energy. There is some flow of energy in a particular system. When this energy flow is cyclic, repetitive, in a closed system, we call that as a circuit. So this is fundamental understanding of a circuit. Okay. Later we'll get into open circuit and short circuit, that those are the special cases. But when we say something as circuit, there is some energy flow in that system, where with the flow of that energy, there is some amount of work done. A particular type of work is done. Okay. So in thermal circuit, heat is flowing. One body is heating up, one body is emitting the heat. Okay. In optical circuit, light is flowing. Today, all of us, we are using mobile phones. The signals are coming through the optical fiber communication. Okay. There are optical fibers laid for this communication purpose. So we are getting every information today is in optical form. You can observe that. I think you studied this in physics. Okay. So that is the flow of information is happening. Okay. Fluid circuit. Simple, a hydraulic crane. You can observe a hydraulic crane or earth movers. We observe a small lever sitting in that small cabin is moving the large amount of soil or mass of the earth. That is happening through the pressure created in the pipes and the levers and the water pistons in the hydraulic system. So the flow of fluid is happening, some work is done. In pneumatic, the air is used. Likewise, to do any work in electric circuit, I need electrons, charge carriers. Now I will call it as current. Can I take analogous current? Not voltage, it is current. Okay. So in electric circuit is the one which is carrying some current to do some work. And if you observe any electric circuit is not giving out the output in the electric form. It is giving out the output in the physical form or in the non-electric form only. Now there are fans in our houses. Electricity is used to make the blades of the fan rotate. So the output of that machine is mechanical energy. Output of that machine is mechanical energy. If you take our lamps, we are getting light. When we switch on that lamp, we are getting light. Light is non-electrical quantity. Okay. If you use mixer, if you use grinder, if you use heater, if you take, for example, if you use an induction heater, the output of that system is heat energy, which is again non-electric. Okay. If you use an electrical vehicle, you see the output is again a mechanical energy, rotational energy, which is again non-electric. See, when we have so many appliances surrounding us, but the output of that appliance is non-electric output. You might have observed this, or if you are not observed so far, you just think of it. None of the appliances or majority of the appliances what we use will give us the output which is non-electric. Even our mobile phones, battery is charged, but the output is what? Either light energy in the form of screen display or sound energy. Whenever we listen to music, we talk to others. Everything is non-electric form only. Okay. Then why we have to analyze electric circuit? Then what is the role of electric or electricity in the system? Why the electric system was built? Why that was built? Because to transfer energy from the place where it is available to the place where it is required, there is no system as efficient as electrical system. Do you agree? Can you imagine to rotate a fan? I am having a large amount of potential energy in Kaveri River, but I want to rotate that fan in my room. Can you imagine a pipeline taking water from Kaveri River to my room so that I can make it fall on the turbine blades, and to that turbine, I will not attach generator, I will attach a fan rotating a blade. Is it practically possible?
No, sir.
No, right? Yes. It is not possible because large amount of potential energy is available at one part of the geography and the requirement may be at another part of the geography. Is it? So if I have to get that energy utilization at the point where it is needed, the energy has to be transmitted from one point to other point. Okay. But with non-electric transmission of energy, you just imagine, is it possible? So easily, so conveniently, so comfortably. The answer is no, we don't get. So what electricity is doing in the entire universe? It is simply acting as an agent which transmits energy from the available point to the required point. So we are electrical engineers or agents handling this power. Yes? Why? Because I will convert the potential energy available at the source to electricity. I will transmit it. Okay, silently it will get transmitted. Have you ever seen the conflict of two transmission lines over it? They will be dead looking. Nothing. When we see transmission lines, we feel okay. They are simply hanging. The moment you touch, you will feel the effect. Yes. So electricity, in most of the cases, we are using to transmit the energy from one point to other point. Or to do certain work. Even if you take the smallest circuit, you take our mobile phone only, which is the smallest handheld circuit in my palm, the source is battery and the output is at speakers. Okay, though you got it in the palm, the source is utilized, the electricity is utilized to generate sound energy and to make it listen to the listener. So ultimately the energy that we are using in our regular life, day-to-day life, is non-electric energy. But I want it at my point, so for that I will be using electricity. Okay? So now it is clear what is electric circuit. Electric circuit is one which carries electricity. Why it has to be, why electric circuit is important? Because transmission of energy is very easy using electricity. It is very easy. Okay? I can heat it. I can use for communication purpose, I can use for heating purpose, mechanical purpose, lifting the weight, whatever. Okay, we can use electricity very conveniently. Okay, now, so electric circuit is the one which carries current and which carries the current and do some work. Now, what is the, this current is, if you see, analogous to kinetic energy. Current is the kinetic energy of the system. Then what is potential energy? Yes?
Battery.
What is potential energy of the electric system?
Batteries.
Batteries, yes. What battery holds? Name, see, potential energy. What is the potential energy of electric system?
They store the charges.
Battery stores charge. If the battery is not there in the AC circuit doesn't have battery. Do you say, can we say that there is no potential energy in the AC system? It is voltage. Can there be current without voltage? Yes. Can there be current without voltage? Hello?
No, sir.
No, right? See, what is voltage? It is EMF. What is EMF?
Electromotive
force. Without electromotive force, there cannot be motion of electrons. Is it true? Yes?
Yes, sir.
Hey, guys, pick up, man. Anybody? Without the force, can there be motion of electrons?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Because we need some force. See, electrons are what? The passive element, the passive quantities. They don't have their own energies. Energies have to be given to them. Is it? If you see the fundamental atomic structure, electrons will be continuously gaining energy and losing energy from the environment. Now suppose in the environment itself there is no energy available. Will the electrons get any energy? Okay, they won't get any of the energies, is it? So to make electrons flow in the system, I need to supply some energy to that electron, and that quantity that is supplying energy is the source. That we call it as EMF source or voltage source. You can call it as battery in DC circuit. In AC circuit, it is directly the generator. Okay. So without the electromotive force, there cannot be current. It means that without voltage, there cannot be current. If I want to get the kinetic energy, there must be some amount of potential energy present. Yes or no? This is fundamental physics.
Yes, yes sir.
Fundamentally, in physics also we studied the same thing. If there should be some kinetic energy to be available in the system, means there should be some potential energy present. Kinetic energy, I think, as per my understanding, cannot exist independently. There must be some reason, and that reason is potential energy. Okay, so in any electric circuit, if a current has to be flown, then there needs some EMF or voltage. Now, will any appliance work if the current in that appliance is zero?
No.
Yes? No. Is it possible?
No, sir.
Now I will connect a fan. Okay. I will connect a fan. And what I will do is, I will not switch it on. I will simply connect it. All of you are, many of you are having the electrical appliances everywhere surrounding us. Now what I will do, I will use an electrical appliance. I will simply connect it to the source, but I will not switch it on. Will the electrical appliance work? It won't work, is it? So in any electric circuit, if you observe, what is the quantity that is doing work? The quantity that is doing work is, suppose you take a, I have a switch here. This is supply terminal. I have a switch here, and to this switch, let us take, I will be connecting a simple lamp. So let this be 230 volts supply. And this is switch, yes. Now I have connected this lamp to this source, but the switch is open. Will the lamp glow? It won't glow. Okay. So the moment I close the switch, the lamp starts glowing. What exactly is happening? The current from the source is flowing to the lamp. Okay. And this current I is converting the electricity into the light energy. So remember one thing, current, okay, it is the quantity that do the work in the system. Okay, potential will exist. Okay, potential will exist. But until and unless current flows into a particular system, then only that particular system starts operating. So in any system, if there is no flow of current, we say, in majority of the cases, we say that system is not working. Okay. So to make the work done in electric circuit, I need current. Okay. To make the current exist in the system, I need voltage. Now, do you find anything other than more important than these voltage and current? Yes. So electric circuit means what? electric circuit
which carries current and
my voltage and current. Okay, electric circuit is my voltage and current. So what circuit analysis is asking us to do is find out the voltage and current. That's it. Because ultimately anything can be calculated. Now if you take power P is equals to V into I, or you can write it as I square R, or you can write it as V square by R. Okay. Once I know voltage and current, I can calculate power, which is another electrical quantity. If you want to find out energy, okay, you can find out power and multiply it with time. So this is energy. So the moment I know what is voltage, what is current, I can find out any electrical quantity associated to any electrical system. So ultimately, what is my aim of studying electrical circuit analysis is to know what is voltage, what is current at every part of the circuit. This is my ultimate aim. Okay, to know what is current and what is voltage in every part of the circuit is my ultimate aim. And that is what we are doing in circuit analysis. Okay, in AC circuit, again, we come across phase, phase difference, phase angle, power factor. Those are, but everything is associated with voltage and current only. Okay, once I know the value of voltage, phase of voltage, value of current, phase of voltage, phase of current, everything else I can calculate. So what electric circuit analysis is asking us to do is find out voltage and current. That's it. Find out voltage and current. Analysis means what? Analysis is what? For me, analysis now is, okay, finding voltage and current. For me, analysis is okay, finding voltage and current. That's it. So now everything, whatever I am doing hereafter, I will be aiming to do that. I will be aiming to find voltage and current. Okay. Now how I can find voltage and current? There are various ways. Now suppose I will give you this very simple circuit. Suppose if I take a small circuit here. It is of say 10 volts, resistance of 10 amps, 10 ohms. Okay. Now I will say analyze. What is what I can do? I know what is the voltage here. I know what is the resistance. What I can find is only the current. Okay, I is equals to 10 volts by 10 ohms. I get as 1 amps. Fine. Now, slightly I will change the same circuit. I will keep this as 10 ohms and I will keep another 10 ohms. Now I will say analyze. Now what you have to do? What you will do?
Resistance in series formula.
Yeah. Okay. So now I knew here there is only one element in the circuit. So whatever the voltage of that circuit is there at the source, the same voltage will appear across this 10 ohms. But when I got a series connection of two resistors, I got to know that this 10 volts will get divided across these two resistors. Now both resistors are same, so it will now get divided equally. If both resistors are different, they get divided unequally. So in my analysis, what should I do? First, I should find out what is the current. Okay. Let this me take it as R1 and let me take this as R2. Then I should be finding it VR1, drop across R1, VR2, drop across R2. Once I know this, I can find out what is the power consumed by this 10 ohm, this 10 ohm. I can find out what is the power consumed by this 10 ohm in the first circuit, all those things I can. So this is what circuit analysis means. Now, if I take the same two 10 ohm resistors in parallel, R1 10 ohms, R2 10 ohms. Now in this circuit, what I will be doing? I will be finding the branch currents. I will be finding I R1, I will be finding I R2, yeah. I will be finding. Okay, so this is what circuit analysis means. So the unknown things or unknown quantities across the elements of the circuit, finding the unknown quantities across the elements of the circuit is called circuit analysis. It is simple. But now see, here it was simple when there was only one element. Now when it got series connection, the number of computations increased. When there is parallel connection, number of computations increase. Now if I go on adding the circuit elements, I have to find out current here in R3, current in R4, current in R5, current in R6, drop across all those resistors and all, so on. So why circuit analysis becomes important is, every time when a new element gets added into the circuit, the circuit analysis becomes more complex. So for that, we need to have circuit reduction techniques. We need to have circuit transformation techniques. We need to have circuit simplification techniques. These all things we will be studying in this entire course. Okay. The intention of taking all these things now is to say, what is the scope of the subject? Okay. The scope of the subject is extremely vast. Because if I add one element here, R7, everything changes in every branch. So that becomes altogether a new circuit. So the scope of circuit is extremely vast, and the entire electrical and electronic industry is standing on circuit analysis only. Because anything or whatever I want to build it, at the base level, I have to analyze it. Once I design, before I implement, I will be analyzing. So when in analysis, if the system is more and more bigger, then analysis becomes more and more complex. So when the need of simplification arises, new techniques will emerge. That is how the development of techniques will happen. Okay. If everything remains simple, I need not to go for complex analysis. Is it complex in the sense more complicated? When the complications increase, then I start finding the new techniques to reduce the complexity in the system or analysis. So that is how the subject has evolved from a simple Ohm's law to various network theorems, to various domain analysis, Laplace domain analysis, Fourier domain analysis, simple circuit domain analysis. The analysis is very vast. It is a very vast subject. Whatever we study in this course is very fundamental things. Okay. So this circuit, this course or this subject forms the base for the entire electrical engineering. This is one of the course which will form the strong base for the entire electrical engineering. Okay, so you should be very much attentive and focused when we study this particular course. Okay, any doubts so far? Anything you want to ask? And if you get any doubt, please note. You have to sit with pen and paper compulsorily. You cannot simply listen to this like a discourse of some Swamiji. and later thinking that okay, any video is available, later I will see. Every day you will get 4 to 5 videos. If you just don't look into your lecture videos for 2 days, there will be 20 videos. So it is not possible to go through all the class content through videos over a night. So it is suggested that you should sit with pen and paper, go through the classes continuously. Any doubts, note it. Okay, you can ask there and then. If it is very small, if you want elaborate explanation, you can discuss in the last 10 minutes anyway. Okay, so far any doubts or anything you feel that you can ask on the things what I have shared? Or any explanation you need more in detail that what I told? Yes? Should I take Maunam Sammati Lakshanam or Asammati Lakshanam?
No doubt, sir, it's clear.
Yes?
No doubt, sir, it's clear.
Okay. One thing. One more small topic I will topic in the sense I told you na in the above one point that without a voltage current doesn't exist. Okay, I will tell you why without current voltage current will not exist. Okay, after that we will end it. Now take a particular conducting material. For example, I have a copper here. Suppose I will take a piece of copper or a copper wire, magnified version of copper wire, and we know that copper is having one free electron. Okay, so before that, briefly, we have three electrical materials. We have three electrical materials in any electrical system: conductor, okay, semiconductor, and insulator. Okay, what is conductor? Quick, what is conductor? Which is capable of easily conducting the current. All three materials will carry current, but at various conditions. If any material is very easily capable of carrying current, he is called conductor. Now, how you recognize a conductor? I will give you some XYZ material in your hand, and I will ask you to tell whether it is conductor or insulator or semiconductor by looking into its atomic structure.
Based on number of free electrons.
Based on?
Free electrons.
Yes, based on valence electrons, is it?
Yes,
based
sir.
On valence. Yes. Based on valence electrons. What is valence electrons? The electrons in the outermost orbit. Is it? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Electrons in the outermost orbit is valence electrons.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, if the number of valence electrons are less than 4, then that material is called as conductor. If number of valence electrons are exactly equal to 4, that material is called as semiconductor. If number of valence electrons are greater than 4, that material is known as insulator. Now, why exactly 4? The question is, why can't it be less than 5, equal to 5, greater than 5? Because maximum valence electrons are 8 in number. Do you remember the electronic configuration? How you assign electrons to orbits? In chemistry, you might have studied.
Yes, sir.
You yes, cannot sir. Fit yes, valence electrons more than 8. The maximum number of valence electrons are 8. Minimum is obviously 1. Yes or no? Now, yes, if sir. The number of valence electrons are lesser than the half of maximum value, then that is a good conductor. If it is exactly 4 or exactly half of the maximum value, that is semiconductor. Greater than half of the maximum value, that is insulator. Now, what happens if less number of valence electrons are there? The question is, valence electrons are more eligible to set free. Is it? If you check the atom, this is a nucleus. This is one orbit. This is second orbit. This is a valence orbit. Okay. Now, if the electrons present in these orbits are more likely to be set free. Yes or no? Why? Because the outermost orbit will be having minimum amount, attractive force between nucleus and the orbit. If I want to detach electron from the second inner outermost orbit, I need more energy. So to detach this valence electron, I need less energy. So to make electrons free, it is more suitable from valence orbits. But if less number of valence electrons are present, we say that is good conductor of electricity. Yes, as per this definition. See, this is not the only atom that is present in the material. How many atoms are there in the material? Infinite number of atoms we have. Now there is neighboring atom also. Here one more atom is there. Is it? I hope you are listening, all of you.
Yes, sir.
Now there are so many number of atoms which are tightly packed in the material. Now if I want to set this electron free, if I want to set this electron free, I should take out from the orbit. But this electron is not singly existing. There is a covalent bonding between another electron of the another atom. Is it? Yes or no? Covalent bonds exist between any two atoms. Valent bond means what? The bond that is existing between two valence orbits. Now observe, all the atoms are of the same material. Definitely all atoms must be having same number of valence electrons in them. Is it? I cannot say this atom is of copper and this atom is of rubber. In the same material, all atoms are of the same material. So therefore, equal number of valence electrons exist. Now observe, if there are 5 valence electrons in a particular atom, there are 5 covalent bonds. Is it?
Yes, sir.
If there is only one valence electron in the orbit or in the material, how many covalent bonds will be there? Only one covalent bond will be there, is it?
Yes, sir.
So where do we need more energy? To break 5 covalent bonds, we need more energy, or to break only one covalent bond, we need more energy?
To break only one.
Only one, is it? So
yes,
copper
sir.
Is having only one valence electron in it. So only one covalent bond has to be broken there. Hence, copper is very good conductor of electricity. Silver is very good conductor of electricity. Aluminium is very good conductor of electricity. Gold is very good conductor of electricity. In that matter, many of the metals are all good conductors of electricity because they are having valence electrons 1 or 2. Yes? Is it true? because you are more nearer to chemistry than me now. I learned chemistry 15 years back. You learned just 2 years back. Is it true or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, how these covalent bonds will break? Will they break on their own?
No, sir.
They will
external break on energy.
Yes. You, if I consider the room temperature.
We apply external energy.
Before application of external energy, what happens we will see. Okay. So now there are, let us assume, now under room temperature conditions, there are lot of free electrons present in this copper conductor. These dots what I am drawing are all free electrons. Okay, which are already been detached from their covalent bonding. Now this copper material is, or copper wire is there in a room which is not connected to any external source. Now under room temperature conditions, the room temperature is sufficient to break the covalent bond of a copper atom. Okay, generally this happens. But the problem is, the energy that is gained by these electrons to break themselves is not directed. Now this electron will gain energy from the room temperature or the surrounding heat, or we call it ambient temperature. It will set itself free and try to move in one direction. This will get itself free, try to move in another direction. This itself will try to move in another direction. This will move in one direction. So if you consider the flow of free electrons in a material under unbiased state or under unenergized state, it is completely random. Now if you take the net moment of the electrons in this material, it will come to zero. Now, what is current? What is the definition of current? Flow of
charges.
Charges. Is it sufficient to define?
Flow of charges.
Now there is a flow of charge, no? This charge is flowing upward, this charge is flowing left, this charge is flowing right, one is downward, one is left at an angle, something. There is a flow. Can I call it as a current?
Flow of charge in a particular direction.
Exactly. Exactly. Flow of charge in a particular direction. In a particular direction. That is current. Now, if I want to make this flow in a particular direction, what should I do? I should apply the external energy in a particular direction. That's it. Now, to this, I will connect a battery. Now, what will happen? The moment I connect battery to this,
the charges move in a particular
direction. Exactly. The charges will orient themselves in a particular direction. I will draw it here. So all the charge carriers will orient themselves in a particular direction. And when the charges flow in a particular direction, they will gain the capacity to do the work. That is what I told in a previous, a moment back, that if the flow of current is not there, that circuit will not do the work. Okay. Now, can you say without voltage, there can be current? Can there be current without voltage?
No, sir.
No, sir.
This is the conventional direction of current. Okay. This is direction of current I that we use in our analysis, but actual direction of current is, this is electron current. Do you think there are two currents existing in the same conductor? One is electron current, one is conventional current. Do you think these two are physically existing? Yes or no? If these two are physically existing, then always the net current should be zero, because this is with the same electrons. This is also with the same electrons. Both are flowing in opposite direction in the same conductor. Always the current should be zero then. Okay. Why there are two currents in a conductor is, yeah, conventional current is the assumed direction of current before electron theory was proposed. It was known that because of flow of charges, there is flow of current. In the chemical electrolytic tank, it was observed when the two electrodes were immersed in the electrolytic tank. It was observed that the two electrodes starts getting charged and there was a flow of charges also observed. Then it was believed that the charges always flow from the anode. This is anode, is it? This is cathode. If you see the fundamental electrolytic cell, positive terminal is anode, negative terminal is cathode. It was believed that charges always flow from anode and they get accumulated to cathode and the flow continues. But when the electron theory was proposed, it was known that electron is a negatively charged particle, and when the external source is connected, all these electrons start getting attracted towards the positive terminal of the battery. That they call it as electron current. But before that, a lot of literature was already built. A lot of books were already written thinking current always flow from positive terminal of the battery. So that convention was retained, though it was later known that the current is due to the opposite direction of flow of electrons. So that is the reason why electron current is opposite to conventional current. The actual current flows in the circuit is electron current, not conventional current. Conventional current we assume to be flowing in the circuit on paper for our analysis. This is the difference between electron current and the conventional current, and this is the reason why without voltage the current will not exist in the system. If I want continuous flow of current, I should be providing continuous supply of voltage. The moment I take out the supply of voltage, the open the switch, then my current stops. So now certain things are clear, I hope. Electric circuit is the circuit that carries current to do the work. Analysis of electric current, electric circuit has to be done to know the voltages and currents at various parts of the circuit, that is across elements of the circuit. Third point, we have seen that there cannot be a current without the existence of voltage. Okay, are these things clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Any doubt? So far, any doubt?
No, sir.
Yeah. Whatever this thing I have noted here, written here on the screen, I will be sharing this also to you in the form of a PDF file. Okay, so you will be getting a video, you will be getting this written, handwritten work page in the class. Okay, you will be getting, you already have got the study material along with you in that Google Classroom. So you are facilitated with everything you want for studying this course. Okay, now the responsibility lies on your part after every class to go through and try to understand. If there are doubts, please get back to me. Okay, we will discuss it. Fine. So with this, we will end today's class. Tomorrow I don't have class for you. Okay, in the next class, we will start from the first topic, that is sources. Okay, source transformation, source shifting, everything will start with that. Okay, so